Hi there, I'm Andrew Brown. Welcome to real-time music and sound in pure data. In this episode, we're going to look at wave shaping. Let me just show you a diagram. So this is the heart of the wave shaping process. It's a wave shaping function or a shaping function. In PD, we're going to implement this in an array or a table. The point is that we have one range going in and a range going out. Typically, it might be from negative 1 to 1 on both, but for PD, we need to have a larger number on the bottom. So we've got a range from 0 to 200 going in, and then a range from negative 1 to 1 going out, and this is our audio that's going to result across that range that we want. The important point is that with a straight line function, of course, the numbers that go in correspond to the numbers that go out in relation to their proportion. So the mid number goes in here, the mid number goes out, the maximum goes in, and then the maximum goes out, and the minimum goes in, the minimum goes out. But if we change this function from a straight line to, say, a curved line, or a jagged line or any other shape, then we get a distortion of the input to the output. And it's this distortion or this shaping of the waveform which introduces additional harmonics and creates a rich timbre for us. So that's the basis of what we're doing. So let's build the wave shaping now. We're going to start with an oscillator as our sound source, and I need to control its frequency, so I'll do so this time with a slider. We'll maybe have a minimum frequency of 50 hertz and a maximum of 1,000. To make this a fairly smooth range from the low frequency to the high frequency, I'm going to use one of the properties of the slider. This button here changes between a linear change to a logarithmic change. Logarithmic change will be better for us for frequency, which is closer to that as a change over time. We'll give it a name, call it frequency, maybe a color just to make it stand out, and we can do that. If we look at if we add a number box for a little bit and look at the frequency, we'll see that it changes. And by making this a logarithmic change, you'll notice that from 50, when we get halfway up, we're nowhere near halfway up to 1,000. It's only 248. And then we get a much sharper curve as we go up. So that's going to be useful for us. As always, we can add a volume control. And again, I might add a slider for my volume control, change the properties so that it goes between 0 and 1. Okay, so if we connect that up there and connect our output to the DAC, then this should just give us a sine wave, and it does, and we can change our frequency, so that's all fine. So this sine wave oscillator is going to be the input to our wave shaper, and so now what we need to do is to implement this process of shaping the wave. Let's start by creating an array. This array, which is going to be our wave shaper, I'm going to give it the name 01 shaping function. Sorry, $0 shaping function. I'm going to make it 200 in size, just because that's a reasonable visual size. I'm going to draw the points together as a polygon and say OK. Now, I'm going to go back to the parameters now that I've created, the properties rather, now that I've created it. So you'll see now there's two property windows open. I'm going to say OK to the first one, which we've already completed. So this one, the X range from 0 to 200 is fine. The output range, we want to go from negative 1 as a minimum to 1. So that means our range from 200, 0 to 200 as an input is going to have an output from negative 1 to 1. And I'm going to make the size on each axis the same, so we get a square. Okay. So that's pretty large. In fact, it's probably a bit too big, so let me reduce that. We'll make that go from 100 to 100. That's more like it. Make the size 100 as well. All right, that's a better size. Now, the interesting thing is you can see that on these tables of these arrays, we can draw. We know that because we've used them previously for showing waveforms. This time we're going to use it as a shaping function. Our numbers are going to come in and they're going to hit the line and bounce out, if you like. And so if there's a fairly straight line, it's hard for me to draw a perfectly straight line, we're going to get similar numbers out as we got in terms of their relationship from the minimum to maximum. Whereas if we draw some odd shape like this, then clearly we're going to get a distorted version of what goes in coming out. So now we need to look at how to read that wave. Our significant object for this task is the tab read object. It's going to read our shaping function. So we need to give it the name of the table or the array that it's reading. It's going to go into that stream there. Okay, so far that sort of makes sense. You would think we could plug the oscillator into the tab read and then the tab read out. And that would be almost right, except our oscillator is giving us values from 0 to 1, and we've scaled this up from 0 to 200, so we need to do some scaling here. So I'm going to, first of all, say plus tilde 1's audio, so it's a tilde. So that now moves the range from 1 to 2. And then I'm going to multiply by 50, which means it will go from 0 to 100. All right, let's see how we're going. All right, and we're working. So you can hear immediately, and you can see on the oscilloscope, that we've got a shape which is quite different from the sine wave that's coming in. And if we try and draw as close as possible to a straight line, you can see that on our oscilloscope, we get something that's pretty close to a sine wave coming out. This works across our frequencies, but as soon as we create a line which is different from that, we get a more complex waveform coming out. Let's see if we can just show that static. We get a more complex waveform coming out. So that's the basis of being able to create a rich spectra of sounds from a simple input. And as you can hear, we can change that dynamically by drawing on our shaping function and make up all sorts of kind of interesting shaping functions. All right, so that's the basis of wave shaping. But there's one additional thing which is kind of very interesting about wave shaping, and that is that the volume of the oscillator can be changed to create interesting effects. If we change the volume of the oscillator, what you have to understand is our input is scanning across the range from the minimum to the maximum. If we turn the volume down, then it's going to scan across a much smaller range. So we're only using, if we turn the volume down, we'll use a smaller part of the shaping function. As we turn the volume up, we'll use all of the shaping function. And this allows us to change the timbre at different volume levels. Let's have a little bit of a demonstration of this. So if I put a volume control by way of a multiply in there, and then use this to control that volume, turn that up close to maximum. In fact, should just make sure I go from 0 to 1 so that we get that up now. So at maximum volume, that's pretty much where we were at before. But what you will hear is as I turn the volume down, not only does the volume drop, but we also get a change in timbre. You can see the shape changing. That's because these rough edges are only coming into effect when our amplitude is wide or loud, and then they don't. So this can be kind of useful in a particular way. Let me show you that. If we use a V-line to create an amplitude envelope, I'm just going to plug that V-line in there. Recall we can now put this back in and get our volume control back. But in addition, the V-line will take a message. We can pass it a series of arguments. We can say go to maximum volume, take 20 milliseconds to get there, and then do another line which is going to go to 0. It's going to take 1,000 milliseconds, 1 second to get there. Don't start that line, give it a delay of 20. So we've got a destination of 1 with a duration of 20 milliseconds, then a destination of 0 with a duration of 1,000 milliseconds and a delay of 20. We put that into our line, send that message. What you can hear is that the attack of the sound has brightness, which then dissipates as the volume drops into the middle. So this is kind of a very interesting way of using wave shaping to create some interesting sounds pretty efficiently. All right, have a go at that, and I'll see you in the next video.